Hello learners, a warm welcome, and in this session we shall be discussing about the general principles of management. I'm Dr. Uma Singh from Delhi University. Now, continuing with our discussion and understanding about the principles of management, from part 4 we learnt about the Taylor's scientific management and the techniques of implementing the principles under the techniques of scientific management. Now, Taylor identified and gave several principles and the techniques, but they were all applicable at factory level or at production floor. As a result, he had a micro perspective. So, the emphasis of implementing the principles and the role of the manager and the administrator in the organization was ruled out. So, the macro perspective of the principles was not taken into consideration by Taylor. As a result, Henry Fayol developed 14 principles of management, which is labeled under the general principles of management, which is applicable to both the managerial as well as the non-technical kind of job. So, these are the principles which have their application in both the technical as well as the managerial levels and in all varieties and different types of organization. So, now let us understand one by one what are these principles all about under the 14 principles of management as identified by Henry Fayol. So, the list of these 14 principles of management which we have to discuss in this session will relate to division of work, authority and responsibility, discipline, unity of command, unity of direction, subordination of individual interest to general interest, remuneration, centralization, scalar chain, order, equity, stability of tenure, initiative, esprit de corps. So, these are the 14 principles of management. Now, let us learn one by one about each one of them in detail. The first principle is division of work. So, this principle suggested that the work must be divided and subdivided up till the last level so that it brings in more specialization and also more expertise in performing the task. So, when the work is divided and allocated among different people and they keep on performing the same task over and over again, it results in specialization of that task performed and also reduction in cost and reduction in the time involved. So, as a result, the efficiency of the workers and the productivity of the organization improves. So, division of work facilitates specialization and improves efficiency of the workers. Subdivision of the works make it simpler because you're performing the task over and over again, and it results in better efficiency of the employees and helps to acquire speed and more accuracy in performance. So, as a result, the worker is able to perform the task more accurately, more speedily, and at the same time there is also reduction in the number of accidents in performing the task. So, this is what is the principle of division of work. Second principle is authority and responsibility. Now, first let us understand what is authority, what is responsibility, and then what is the principle of authority and responsibility. So, authority means the right to give orders, right to command, or right to manage people and things so as to ensure performance. So, it is a right that is exercised by your superiors to extract work and exactness from the subordinates. And responsibility means an obligation to perform the assigned task or the work allocated. So, responsibility is the work assigned to the person and his or her obligation to perform the task in the desired manner. Now, the principle states that there has to be a parity between authority and responsibility, Parity means that there has to be a balance between authority and responsibility, because they should go hand in hand for effective results. Authority without responsibility will lead to irresponsible behavior, whereas responsibility without adequate authority will make the person ineffective. So there has to be a proper balance between authority as well as responsibility. So if you give more authority to a person without a designated responsibility, then it will lead to unnecessary chaos, confusion and irresponsive behavior, and finally the task will not be done. Similarly, if more of responsibility is given without giving authority, then the person will not be able to deliver the task involved, because he does not have the power or the capacity or the authority on various aspects of, let's say, resources or the other methods and machinery. So there has to be a proper balance between both the aspects in order to accomplish the task successfully. Third principle is that of discipline. Now, what does discipline mean? Discipline means obedience, respect for authority, and observation of rules and regulations of the enterprise. Now, no organization or no business, or in fact no work, can be accomplished until and unless it is performed in a disciplined manner. So discipline is very essential and very much required to accomplish a task. Now, this principle emphasizes that subordinates should respect their superiors and obey their orders. On the other hand, superiors' behavior also should be such that they make the subordinates obedient. And this principle provides that if the discipline is observed, that will ensure the running of the enterprise smoothly. So if there is no discipline, what will happen is there will be unnecessary chaos, confusion and conflict. So in order that the work is done in a best possible manner, obedience and sincerity is very much required. So if discipline has to be maintained, then there has to be good supervision at all levels, clear explanation of the rules and practices of the organization, and also essential is that a system of reward and punishment must be implemented at all levels, so as to inculcate that obedience among both the superiors as well as the subordinates. Fourth principle is unity of command, and this is a very, very important principle identified under the general principles of management. Now, this principle states that a subordinate or the worker should receive orders and instructions only from one superior. If unity of command is not followed, what will happen? There will be unnecessary confusion and conflict, and as a result, the instructions would not be followed and the work will not be performed in the desired manner. So if a person is receiving orders from multiple people, you can very well imagine what will happen, that he'll be confused as to whom he has to follow. And as a result, there'll be unnecessary conflicts, and finally the task will not be performed. So this principle emphasizes upon the fact that the orders and instructions to a subordinate must come, and come only from one superior, so that there is no clarity of work leading to chaos and confusion, there is no delay in work and action, and also it does not affect the efficiency of the subordinates. So this is about the principle of unity of command. Next is unity of direction, that is one head and one plan. Now, each group of activities having the same objective must have one head and one plan. Now, what this means is that the entire emphasis of the group of people, the resources used, the equipments and tools that are being used must be directed towards accomplishing a single objective. Because again, if each person has their own objective in a group or in a team or in an organization, what will happen? You can again very well imagine that all of them would be working in a different direction. There is no unity of action, and it will lead to unnecessary wastage of resources, unnecessary conflicts and rivalry among the group members or the team members. So this unity of direction emphasizes upon the fact that there is one head and one plan, leading to unity of action, that is coordination and uniformity in the activities that are performed in a team or in a group or in an organization. Then it also reduces the duplication of activities. Then because of this, it helps in minimizing the wastage of resources and ultimately the achievement of common goals. So right from one head to one plan, how step by step each one is linked, leading to the fact that your final goals or the common goals for which the group or the team or the organization is existing should be achieved. The next principle, sixth principle under general management, is subordination of individual interest to general interest. So while taking any decision, the collective good and collective interest of the organization as a whole must be preferred over individual interest. So this principle emphasizes the priority or emphasis of the general organizational interest over the individual interest. So as individuals, when we join the organization, we all have different interests. But if we all start into the fact that we have to fulfill our own individual interest, then as a result, the ultimate objective or aim of the organization will get sidelined. So this principle emphasizes on the fact that the organizational objectives must be given priority over the objectives of the individuals, because organizations are always above individuals. So the general interest or the interest of the organization is supreme. It is above everything. This ensures welfare of the organization as well as the welfare of the individual. So if the organization is performing well, it is doing good, as a result, the impact or the effect will be gamed by the employees or the members. Next principle is that of remuneration. Now, remuneration is what the amount you are giving to your employees for the services that they are rendering to the organization. Now, in identifying or giving the wages and salaries to the employees, it is essential that the wages or the salaries given to the employees must be reasonable and as per the satisfaction of the workers and the productivity of the organization. So the services that are being rendered by the employees must be given a fair wages. So fair means it should be reasonable, just, it should be equitable. And these wages or salaries or rewards can be in the form of monetary rewards, or they can be in terms of non-monetary rewards. So monetary rewards would be the money compensation that you are offering to your employees or your laborers. And the non-monetary rewards are in terms of not the money part, but in terms of better working conditions, more incentives, bonus, recognition or decision making or initiatives. So the rewards that are being finally given to the employees must be adequate, must be fair, must be equitable in all respects. Next principle is that of centralization. Now, first of all, what does centralization mean? And then we come to the principle of centralization. When a single person controls the affairs of the organization, it is said to be centralization. That means all the decision making powers are in the hands of one single person. Then that concept is referred to as centralization. Now, in big organization, the control or the decision-making power is divided among number of people so as to facilitate operational decision-making and also to save time. That concept is referred to as decentralization. Now, for smaller organization, centralization can very well go because there are few number of people. But as the organization expands, it introduces more products, more processes, and it diversifies its branches, then it becomes very difficult for a single person to control the organization. And in that case, you have to divide your decision-making power among different people. That concept is referred to as decentralization. Now, Fayol emphasized under this principle that there has to be a proper balance between centralization and decentralization in the organization or the delegation of your decision-making authority among the people. Now, this principle emphasizes that there has to be a proper balance between centralization and decentralization or the delegation of authority among the employees in the organization. So, all the higher decision-making power, which is of utmost importance, can be maintained with the higher authorities through centralization, and something which is not very important and can be easily delegated so as to save time as well as to save resources can be decentralized, and this will also ensure that the decision making is not delayed. So, there again has to be a proper balance between what is to be centralized and what needs to be delegated. Next important principle under general principles, the ninth principle, is the principle of scalar chain. Now, every organization has a particular hierarchy from higher level to lower level. Now, this chain of authority relationships from the highest to the lowest rank is what is referred to as a scalar chain. And this scalar chain implies that any communication that has to be sent from a lower to a higher level must pass through different stages as per the organizational hierarchy. Similarly, any communication from a higher level to a lower level should also be properly communicated step by step as per the organizational hierarchy. As you can see in the diagram, if anything is to be communicated from D to A, so it has to pass through the organizational hierarchy from employee D to C, then C to B, and then B to A. Similarly, if the higher level wants to communicate anything to, let's say, the lower employee, that is G, he cannot directly communicate. He has to follow a scalar chain from higher to a lower level, following the orders from A to E, then E to F, and F to G. So, this is what is a chain of authority which binds together the organizational hierarchy in the structure. So, the order of this chain should be maintained whenever some instructions are to be passed or inquiries to be made. So, this is essential that any kind of communication from a lower to a higher level or from a higher level to a lower level must follow a certain hierarchical system. But then he gave an exception to this principle of scalar chain, which is referred to as the principle of gangplank. Now, this concept was developed to establish a direct contact with the employee of an equal rank in case of emergency or to avoid any kind of delay in communication. If sometimes there is an urgency, there is an emergency, and you feel that by following the organizational hierarchy, it may delay the work, then in that case, he also offers an exception to the principle by the name of gangplank, wherein, as you can see from the diagram, that D can now directly communicate with G at the same level. So, D does not have to pass through the lower level to the higher level and then from higher level to lower level. The direct communication among the employees but at the same level is also possible. This will ensure the decision to be taken in a fast manner, or anything that is to be communicated among them, it will save a lot of time. The next principle is that of order. Now, order refers to the placement of men, material and things in the organized manner. Now, this principle is again a very, very important principle which talks about how the people and how the resources and material have to be organized in the system or in the business. Now, proper space should be made available where the materials and resources can be kept safely, and also whenever you require, you can immediately take out the material and use them. You are not unnecessarily wasting time in either searching them or unnecessarily leading to delay of work. And similarly, every person or employee should also have a designated place, an orderly place to accomplish the task, so that again it leads to efficiency, and whenever that person has to be called upon, you know that this is the place from where this person can be made available to. So as a result to this, he identified two types of orders. One is material order and the other is social order. So material order is for physical things or physical resources, which emphasized a proper place for everything and everything in its right place, with the only intention that you are maintaining your resources or you're maintaining your things in a proper and an organized manner, and whenever they are to be used or they are to be delivered to anyone, you can immediately find them because you know that this is where they are being maintained or kept. Similarly, the second type of order is social order, which is for the employees or for the human resources, and it emphasized a place for everyone and everyone at their designated or appointed place. So every employee knows that this is what my designated place is, and I have to perform my task in this place, in this cabin or this room. And if anyone is looking out for that employee or a person, he or she also knows that this person would be available at this designated place. So it definitely saves a lot of time, improves your efficiency, and of course gives a good look to the organization. You can very well imagine if the things are not organized in your house or they are not organized in your room, what will happen? There will be an utter chaos. But if the things are arranged properly, you save a lot of time, and of course it looking at that room or looking at that house. So the same goes for the organization also. Next principle is the 11th principle of equity. Now this principle requires that the managers must be kind and just to their workers. That means that they should treat their employees, they should treat their workers in a very, very friendly manner. And this will promote a good and a cohesive atmosphere in the overall organization. A good proactive and a positive culture will be developed between the superiors and the subordinates, and both of them will have a sense of belongingness and loyalty towards their organization. So the principle requires that the employees must be treated well. So the principle is about the treatment of employees, which should be just, must be fair, must be unbiased or impartial, and must be equal. For the organization, all the employees are equal, and as a result, the treatment or how you are treating your employees must be unbiased and fair and impartial. Now, the consequence of this would be when you treat your employees in a just and an equitable manner, it will provide for more loyalty, more dedication, more commitment, and more attachment to the organization. So as a result, if the employees are treated well, they are treated equal, it will result in more attachment and more commitment and more developing a sense of belongingness to the organization by the employees. Next principle is the principle of stability of tenure. Now this principle is about the continuity of the employees with the organization, so as to provide stability in their tenure. The employee should not be frequently terminated or forced to quit from the organization, which is neither in the interest of the organization nor in the interest of the employees. If you keep on frequently terminating the employees, what will happen is that as a result, you will not be able to find good, loyal and dedicated employees, which in the long run will not be very supportive for the organization. So, employees should be provided stability and continuity of their tenure in the employment. There should not be frequent termination, and this can be achieved through providing them with good working conditions, an attractive remuneration, and we just discussed about an equitable treatment of the personnel. So, this will ensure that the employees do not quit your organization very frequently. The rationale of stability of tenure of labor implies that the rate of labor turnover will be slow. So, if you are maintaining the stability of tenure, the rate of labor turnover will be slow. Cost of recruitment, selection and training will be minimized, and it will also help in maintaining the organizational efficiency. So, if the employees are not terminated very frequently, then these would be the benefits which then organization can have. The next principle is that of initiative, which implies encouraging your employees to be initiative in taking more creativity, more innovation, and being a part of decision making activities. So, through suggestions, involvement, freedom of expression, decision making, and enhancing creativity, you are increasing their initiative in the organization. And when the organization increases the initiative among the employees or encourages initiative among the employees, it leads to more confident employees, it leads to better self-motivation, and provides a sense of belongingness and devotion to the organization. The last principle is the principle of esprit de corps. Now, this is a French word which means inculcating a spirit of harmony and team spirit. So, managers should infuse the spirit of teamwork and cooperation among the employees. So, they should be made to act and think like a group. So, a spirit of harmony, cooperation must be inculcated, which will help in developing mutual trust and a sense of unity. So, when the people join hands and work together for the organization, definitely it will enhance more results and better efficiency for the organization. So, these are the 14 principles that we discussed under the general principles of management, which are highly flexible and capable of adaptation. A very important aspect of these general principles of management is that they have a macro perspective, implying that they are applicable to both the technical and the non-technical jobs. Unlike Frederick Winslow Taylor's scientific management, which emphasize more at the factory level, these principles are applicable to both the factory level also and to the managerial jobs also. And they can be used to manage organization and are useful for forecasting, planning, process management, decision making, coordination and control. So, these are the 14 principles which we discussed in this general principles of management. I hope you have understood the 14 principles of management and would be able to appreciate it better when you read more about it in the books. Thank you.